like sledding and sleeting, like my heart is beating, like your hair is receding. Reading Theater Project Live! What's reading and reading? That pagoda is gleaming. Do you pick up my meaning? It's the end of our greeting.
Good evening, and welcome to Reading Reading, a play reading series from the Reading Theater Project. I'm your host, Adam Richter. Before we begin, I want to give a thank you to Berks Community Television and the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts for making this show possible. Here at Reading Reading, we talk to playwrights and perform their short plays on the air. If you are a playwright watching this and you would like to have your work featured on the show, send an email to plays@readingtheaterproject.com with information about yourself and about the and a copy of the play that you'd like us to read. Tonight, our guest playwright is Bruce Walsh from Elizabethtown, Pennsylvania. Welcome, Bruce. Since receiving his MFA in playwriting from Indiana University Bloomington in 2017, Bruce's plays have been produced around the country, winning the Heidemann Award, the Kennedy Center's Gary Garrison National 10-Minute Play Award, and the Maxim Mazumdar New Play Competition. I hope I pronounced that correctly.
That's correct.
Good. In a previous life, he was a longtime arts reporter for the Philadelphia Metro and City Paper, and he currently teaches literature and creative writing at Messiah University. He lives in Elizabethtown, PA, with his wife and son. Bruce, welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me.
Absolutely. We're going to be reading, actors Daniel Smith and Aaron Rainier will read from your play, Brambles. Daniel is reading the part of B, while Aaron is reading the part of A. Did I get that right?
Other way around.
Other way around. Okay. Daniel is reading the part of A. Aaron will be the consonant, the part of B. So without any further ado, let's get started with Brambles. A sits outside at a table. B stands.
Are you just going to stand there? Are you my son?
No.
You look like you could be my son from here. My eyes don't work so well. Are you a lawyer?
No.
Nurse?
Yes.
Come over here and sit. Sit if you have a minute. Do you have a minute? In the mornings I come out here and stare into the brambles. The dark, hidden places. I think I used to know the word, but I can't. Not crickets. What is that? The sort of high-pitched rattle there.
Cicadas.
Cicadas. Yes. Okay. Yes, I'm glad you sat down. Thank you. But I can hear crickets too. There they are. In these darker parts, the crickets go all day long. I've noticed that on overcast days, particularly a kind of low, somber sound when you stop and listen, a wobbly sleigh bell. Hiding in the grass. That is what I picture.
I'm sort of more into birds. I'm a birder, amateur birder.
Yeah. Well, that's something.
I think I should.
Have you met my son?
Yes, actually.
If you could remember, sorry, I'm interrupting, but. But if I don't get it out, it's liable to slip away, because what I'm finding, my mind doesn't always recall previous frequencies, you could say. But the next time he visits, if you could simply remember that I wanted to ask him about his first bicycle.
Of course, but
Does he remember it? Does he remember the day I put the training wheels on? Does he remember what color it was, or if it was a Huffy? I pray it wasn't a Huffy. I was too stingy in those days. I am hoping that I didn't buy him a Huffy. For God's sake. I can see him riding in circles in the driveway in my mind's eye. I was too cheap to buy him a bicycle helmet, so he was wearing his T-ball helmet. It worked just as well, so why spend the... This is how I was then. When I think of it now, for God's sake, I had cursed and sweated getting the training wheels on there. They gave you two different sets of directions in the box, and it didn't come with all of the parts. And I'd paid $38 for the damn thing, but then I got them on, and I was watching from the kitchen window. He was singing to himself and riding in circles in his T-ball helmet, and I think I was crying. I think this was so. I remember laughing to myself because I discovered that I was crying. My mind isn't as sharp, you understand, but I've got a pile of old date books in my desk. I've been going week by week, circling dates, recalling. I used to write a sentence or two for each day. Finally, I got the training wheels on. David riding circles in the driveway. An exclamation point for that sentence. An exclamation point. There are no other exclamation points in any of my date books. I've checked. What I've come to, I think that may have been the happiest moment of my life. That day with the training wheels and the T-ball helmet. So if you could tell him when you see him, because the trouble is, it might slip away. It might slip away before he... Could you tell him for me?
He's in the car.
If you're his lawyer, I'm going to scream. I'll tell them that you're giving me one of them arm burns kids used to give. And I'll tell them you're one of those old people torturers.
I'm not a lawyer.
A nurse?
Yes. No.
Which is it? I've got you on the stand now. If you try to get me to sign something, I've got pipes on me, and they'll hear me up in the rec room on the hill.
Yes, I'm a nurse. No, I don't work here.
Well, now I'm confused again, but of course this happens so often.
Your son's husband.
Pleased to meet you.
We've met.
Sorry.
It was a very long time ago. It's no problem. You haven't seen him in 8 years.
I thought he visited every week, or month, or perhaps that is something I hoped for. It is harder to remember certain facts these days, but I find it is easier to live in your fantasies. I'm dying, aren't I? That's why you brought him here. Yes, I remember. I remember now. I tend to lose track of it, this fact, and it is a fact which occasionally resurfaces.
Sorry.
No, please. Do you hear the, what is it again?
Cicadas.
Cicadas, yes. Strange that I never looked into such things when I was younger. How many days of my life did I walk from the car to the back porch, fumbling with keys? There were too many keys on there. One of them from some old apartment, fumbling the keys. Perhaps I've got some takeout food in my arms, and all the while, there were cicadas, deafening in the early evening. And did I notice? Did I ever stop and wonder?
I think you're too hard on yourself.
Was I terrible to you? When we met, was I terrible to you?
Yes.
For God's sake.
It was a long time ago.
Why won't you get out of the car? I suppose there are things that you can't say for others.
I could kill him for this.
Oh, don't kill him.
We just drove 11 hours.
He's a good boy.
He's stubborn and self-righteous.
And a little greedy, maybe. He knows too many Philadelphia lawyers.
If he doesn't talk to you, he'll regret it. I told him. I don't know how many times I...
He's not hurting me. I won't remember this tomorrow.
My dad died 6 years ago.
I'm sorry.
I think of it every day.
What do you think of?
What do I... I don't know. He was a small person. And I showed him every day what a smaller person looks like.
I see.
So I am smaller now, I think. This is what I think of. When I think of it, it's that's neither here nor there. That's me. Perhaps I shouldn't. Oh, look, a goldfinch. That yellow bird there.
Ah.
On a good day, I notice the birds. I have a little book at home. I look them up. I know I'm having a good day when a goldfinch flits across my... Oh, look, the way it darts in big looping arcs. I always wonder, how long do they remain in the air with their wings tucked in?
They tuck in their wings?
Oh, they fly, their wings flapping. Then they tuck them in and glide. Glide like a baseball, I always think, like a ball being thrown with purpose.
Ah, yes, I see. There. I see what you mean, yes. Look at that fucker go. And there's his friend. Yeah, I see. Both of them there. That's, well, they really are something. Bring him to me. Or let's go to the car together.
We can't.
Why?
He's driven off. He texted to say he's sending an Uber for me.
What's that one?
Catbird.
Not as pretty.
No.
But still, handsome in its way.
Yes.
Slate gray, no color, but sharp and angular. Stay with me, will you? And we'll look in the Brambles a little while longer.
Blackout. End of play. Well done, guys.
Thank you.
So, there's a lot in this play, but
I'm just thinking that.
One thing you don't have a lot of are names or stage directions, and I want to find out from you first. When we talk about your greater work, I want to get into this play a little bit. Is that typical of your style to sort of keep it minimalist like that?
I try and leave out as much as I can in terms of stage directions. I tend to be pretty. I tend to be a lot more verbose than this, but I think in between plays, I like to write a short play to kind of check myself a little bit. And so I think I was working with some things that I typically give students, but I don't put in my own work. I'm really interested in this playwright, Maria Irene Fornes. And she's has these directives that are just, you know, have two people sitting in a setting that you can really taste and you can really imagine and see what they say to each other. So kind of without a plan, I just tried to do that and see how the nature kind of came to it. And because I was doing it that way, I think I wanted to keep everything else as sparse as possible.
Right. So to back up a little bit, what got you into playwriting? In the first place, you got your master's degree in it.
Well, that's a long sordid history. Let me see if I can abbreviate it. I mean, my dad was an actor in community theater and very interested in theater, he had like a shelf of plays in the house, and I found William Inge there. I found particularly Neil Simon. And I found I loved reading plays as a young person because you could kind of get in an afternoon what you might get from a novel in a month or something. And that really connected with me, maybe my laziness or something. maybe it's just like an auditory thinker. Mm-hmm. I could hear the actors. I could hear it talking.
Right.
So that was kind of the beginning, and it's been a long journey since then. It took me until I was maybe 31 or 33 or so to start writing every day, and you don't really get anywhere until you start doing that.
Right. Well, I heard someone say a long time ago that you're supposed to live in your 20s and write in your 30s. So it sounds like you find
it
really well.
I did it right.
Exactly.
I did it right.
Exactly. So we talked a little bit about the structure of Brambles, but how did the story come to you?
I don't know, because this is typically, you know, with a full-length play, I'm kind of chewing on that for a really long time. Mm-hmm. And with this, I think I tried to keep it as loose and open as Maria Irene Fornes would have liked, but something about me tends to, I don't know, focus in a little bit. Yeah. So with this, when you're sort of like improvising in a 10-minute play like that, you're sort of finding things between the characters, and so there's things in your instincts that are like, oh, that's interesting, oh, that reveal is interesting. So I think, and for whatever reason in my unconscious, well, I know the reasons, themes of fathers and sons are very prevalent for me. Mm-hmm. Just around my friends, there's some of these characters are very close to situations my friends are in, and I have a son, and I think about it a lot. And so I think some of the imagery of the kid on the training wheels and the T-ball helmet, and I'm thinking, why didn't I get him a real helmet? Why is he wearing a T-ball helmet?
Is that from real life?
All of the guilt. am I going to be on my deathbed? You know, like, why didn't I get him a proper helmet? And just the stress of trying to pay the bills and, handle your schedule, and also not noticing maybe the most important things.
Yeah. I think one of the things that I really liked about this play is that it's a story of fathers and sons where the son is not even, doesn't even make an appearance.
I think that's something in the instincts, too, of like recognizing, and Dad, hi, if you're watching, but recognizing it's hard to speak face to face with the people you love about the things that are difficult on the nose.
Yeah.
And so you often need a medium. Mm-hmm. And it just felt far more interesting to me to have this. They're both sort of stand-ins for each other.
Yeah.
Of these people that they need to work things out. And they can only really work them out through each other, I think.
All right. Well, we have a few minutes. I wanted to bring the actors into the discussion. What do you guys think about the play, about your characters?
Yeah, I can go first. I found it wonderfully subtle, yes, in many ways, and able to relate what you said, Bruce, too, that saying that we don't, certainly what I can relate to is we don't always open up completely, you know, especially in the day and age with my father and, you know, in growing up there, there was a lot of perhaps understanding, but not in direct communication. Mm-hmm. And so that was, you know, very, very difficult at times. I also understood, and he understood, I think, that there was a lot of compassion and a lot of love between us, but we didn't always communicate directly with words. So at times that was very difficult, but there were also times as I got older and he got older. In fact, my father just passed away a couple of months ago at the age of 95.
Wow.
But and what I can say is that as we both got older, it was, easier for us to show love and compassion, sometimes with words and other times without words.
Yeah.
But so we didn't openly communicate about my sexual orientation ever, but there was a lot of, indirect communication. And it certainly was not at all like this father and son, because we did we were able to show love and compassion, as I said, not with direct communication but indirect. So, and I'm very grateful for that, as because it was a tough time growing up in the late 50s, 60s, and sometimes 70s, but. It did get better, I would say, as time went on. So,
okay. Aaron, very quickly, I'm sorry we're running out of time, but I want to get your thoughts on your character. And,
no worries. I think this is such an impactful play. I mean, I cried the first time that I read it. Coming out is something that's like unique to the LGBT community. Working at the LGBT Center of Greater Reading, I see this on a daily basis. And luckily, there are resources now that like Dan was talking about, just didn't exist in the past.
Yeah.
So now there is family therapy that can assist families with this. So it's a really hard thing and a great thing to shine light on.
Great. Thank you. Well, that's our show. I want to thank Daniel Smith, Aaron Rainier, and of course Bruce Walsh for allowing us to read his fantastic play, Brambles. Bruce is also one of the co-founders of the Lancaster Dramatists platform, so you can look them up if you are interested in that. It's a really great group. Thanks again to BCTV and the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts. Once again, if you are a playwright, especially a playwright in the Reading area, which includes Lancaster County, and you want to be on a future episode of Reading Reading, please send an email to plays@readingtheaterproject.com. You can follow Reading Theater Project on Facebook and Twitter, Instagram, and YouTube. You can follow me on Twitter at Rick Terrific. Bruce, are you on social media?
Yeah, Bruce Ponders Plays at Instagram.
There you go. How about you guys? Any social media handles you want to plug?
Not for me.
Okay, all right. Thank you so much for watching. I'm your host, Adam Richter. Have a good night.
It's Reading and Reading, like sledding and sleeting, like my heart is beating, like your hair is receding. Theater Project Live!
On BCTV.
What's Reading and Reading? That pagoda is gleaming.